Hey, welcome to 12 Tone. Wendy Carlos is a pioneer in the world of synthesizers who worked with Robert Moog and helped popularize his new electronic instruments. Her album Switched on Bach went platinum and won 3 Grammys, and she wrote innovative scores for movies including The Shining and Tron. She's also transgendered and was one of the first public figures to disclose having undergone gender reassignment surgery. If you'd like to know more about her life, the Listener's Guide did a great video about her, but today I'd like to focus on her work. Specifically, an article she wrote called 3 Asymmetric Divisions of the Octave. What does that mean? Well, let's back up a second. When you hear a note, what you're really hearing is a sound wave with a specific frequency, and the intervals we perceive are based on the ratios between those frequencies. For instance, this note is 220 Hz or cycles per second, and this note is 440 Hz, which is twice as fast. That gives us a 2-to-1 ratio between the two notes, which is what we call an octave. Other important ratios include 3 to 2, known as the perfect fifth, 4 to 3, the perfect fourth, and 5 to 4, the major third. But most of those ratios don't really exist in modern music, at least not exactly. Mathematically speaking, it'd be impossible to tune every interval correctly, so instead, we approximate them. The most common system by far is to take the octave and break it up into 12 evenly spaced intervals called half steps. These give our scales a nice symmetry, but it means that every interval is slightly out of tune. Well, every interval except for one. The most common solution to this is to just use more notes. If we broke the octave up into smaller intervals, like say 19 even steps, we could get an even better approximation of our intervals. It wouldn't be perfect, but still, better is better. This approach led to a group of tunings called Edo systems, short for equally divided octave, and they're generally considered some of the best candidates for more beautiful tuning. 19 Edo especially is a favorite of many theorists, although for some reason the public doesn't seem to care as much about our mathematical ideals. But all these systems take one thing for granted. The octave is, for lack of a better word, sacred. We can roughly approximate every other interval, but we have to have perfect 2-to-1 ratios, or what's the point? And it's certainly true that octaves are a big deal, but Carlos wondered if, perhaps, they weren't really worth all that effort. Why not? Well, for all its benefits, the octave does come with one downside, overrepresentation. Take the perfect fifth, like from E to B, it's got a 3 to 2 ratio. But if we instead go from B up to the next E, we get the perfect fourth with 4 to 3. Theorists call this process inversion, but Carlos had another word for it. Redundant. We've got two different names for what is, in effect, the same interval, just upside down. And while that's certainly not damning indictment of the octave, it's enough justification to at least look at systems without it. Before we continue, a brief aside on terminology. When we're talking about tuning, we often need to refer to very small differences in frequency ratios. To do this, we invented a unit called the cent equal to 1/100th of a half step. A cent is way too small to be perceived by human ears, even highly trained ones. Here, give it a shot. Yeah, nothing. You need about 5 to 10 cents before you can start to really hear the difference. But still, cents allow us to very precisely describe interval sizes, which lets us compare them to things we're more familiar with, like the half step. Okay, back to our story. If you're gonna kill the octave, you need a good reason, and Carlos's was simple. Consonants. Much like the Edo systems from earlier, she wanted to find better approximations of the various intervals and thought it might be easier to do if she didn't bother preserving the octave. She programmed a computer to check for promising candidates and found 3, which she named Alpha, Beta, and Gamma. Alpha is the closest to our familiar tuning with a step size of 78 cents, and it completely misses the octave. The closest interval is this one, which is about 30 cents flat. In total, alpha has roughly 15 and a half steps per octave, but octaves aren't all that important here. How does it do on the other intervals? Well, let's start with a perfect fifth. A perfectly tuned 3 to 2 ratio should be about 702 cents, and if we take 9 of our alpha steps, we wind up with 702 cents. We nailed it exactly, or at least to within around 5% of a cent. The major and minor thirds are both around 3 to 4 cents off from where they should be, much closer than the roughly 15 cent error that standard tuning has. Its major third is actually even closer than 19 Edos, which as I mentioned is widely considered the best option beyond our standard 12. Here, listen to a major triad from Alpha. It may sound a bit off because your ears are used to standard tuning, but trust me, it's ridiculously pure. Alpha also has another feature. It lets you split the minor third in half. That is, its minor third is made of 4 alpha steps, which means that unlike standard tunings or 19 Edo, there exists an interval that is exactly half the size of the minor third, so you can write melodies like this that traverse that space evenly. Plus, it nails the harmonic second in interval with a ratio of 7 to 8, which most popular Edo systems miss by a mile. Anyway, beta steps are a little smaller at 63.8 cents each, adding up to slightly less than 19 per octave. This makes it sound pretty close to 19 Edo, but by sacrificing the octave, we get to improve a lot of our other intervals. For instance, one of 19 Edo's weaknesses is its perfect fifth, which is about 7 cents flat, whereas just like alpha, beta pretty much nails it. The major third is closer too. Here's a major triad in beta tuning. Again, a very pure sound. Gamma, the last one, is smaller still at 35.1 cents per step and a little over 34 steps per octave. This is getting into deeply microtonal territory, so comparing it to more macroscopic scales isn't really fair. Instead, let's turn to what's often considered the holy grail of microtonal tuning, 53 Edo. It doesn't see much use because it's pretty impractical to construct, but in theory, its approximations of harmonic intervals are basically unparalleled. So how does gamma stack up? Well, on the octave it obviously fails. The best it can do is this, which is about 7 cents flat, whereas 53 Edo nails it by definition. But on the perfect fifth and the major and minor thirds, gamma is actually closer. Slightly. Very slightly. We're talking fractions of a cent here. Both tunings are so close that the human ear has long since given up on telling the difference, but mathematically speaking, gamma does better, despite only having about half as many notes. Is that worth the cost of a flat octave? Well, that depends, but the fact that that's even a question worth asking tells you a lot. Before we go, I do want to clarify something. This is far from the only thing Wendy Carlos has done. I've talked before about composers like Kehonen and Caro, for whom a single experimental idea consumed their entire musical life, but Wendy Carlos's work is full of experiments of all kinds. In fact, as far as I can tell, she only used these scales once in the title track for her album Beauty and the Beast, where each song contained a different experimental device. I couldn't find an authorized, freely available version online, but the album is up on her website, which I've linked in the description. Anyway, thanks for watching. If you want to help make these videos possible, please consider supporting Proton on Patreon or checking out our store. You can also join our mailing list to find out about new episodes, like, share, comment, subscribe, and keep on rocking.